Friends, this morning, our speaker will be sharing his insight and wisdom in what we know will be an inspiring and uplifting message. So please help me welcome to the podium our pastor, Reverend John Scott, for this morning's encouragement. Reverend John.
Thank you, Jen. Morning again, family. You know, we have another christening next week. I just love it. And next week, it's twins. My hand full, my heart full, everything full. So welcome to another beautiful Sunday morning at the Temple of Light Center for Spiritual Living. And welcome to those who join us on the World Wide Web. It's a beautiful day here in Jamaica. The sun is shining. It's balmy and warm. And we have babies in our hearts, in our minds, in our consciousness, new life. Today is supposed to be the first day of spring, I believe, abroad. So we bless them. Yes. Well, my encouragement this morning is titled, Wait, I Say on the Lord. It's a line from Psalm 27, verse 14, which reads, Wait on the Lord, be of good courage, and he shall strengthen thine heart. Wait, I say on the Lord. And as you know, wherever in the Bible you see references to the Lord, the word the Lord, you can substitute the word law. So when the 23rd Psalm says, the Lord is my shepherd, you can also use the word law and say, the Lord is my shepherd. Okay. The mystics throughout the centuries have been trying to teach us to wait on the law of mind, the law of cause and effect, the law that always produces whatever we plant in its fertile soil. Now, there has been much misunderstanding about this waiting on the Lord business. It doesn't mean that if you have prayed, you sit and twiddle your thumbs and do nothing. It doesn't mean that. If you are desirous of the perfect partner with whom to share your life, it might be a good idea to seek out situations where you are likely to meet eligible mates. Mr. or Mrs. Wright is probably not going to materialize in the bedroom, or better still, in the kitchen fixing you breakfast to serve you in bed. If you want a new car and your practitioner has done a powerful prayer around the idea of right transportation for you, you probably should go test drive the car of your choice. So waiting on the Lord doesn't mean doing nothing. It means what I'm going to share with you this morning. So why wait? Charmalyne Shaw, one of our Temple of Light family, who is a diligent truth student, in fact, I would call Charmalyne a truth experiencer because she lives the science of mind in her own unique and deeply spiritual way, has some thoughts on why wait. And I've asked her to share them with us this morning. Charmalyne, there she is. Let's welcome her to the podium. Welcome.
Thanks. Good morning, family.
Good morning, Charmalyne.
Thank you. As a child growing up, whenever I had problems, my mother, and I ran to my mother, she would say, oh, wait on the Lord. She said it with a lot of confidence and disdain, so I knew that my problem was no challenge because I could just wait. So I grew up with that experience, but about 10 years ago, everything that I could think of went wrong. And I started to wonder, what did she know what she was talking about when she told me to wait? What did she mean by wait? Because I've been waiting all my life, and now here I am, a bag full of problems, and I'm chanting, wait on the Lord, be of good courage, and it's not working. And I'm filled with anxiety, and I'm filled with worry. But I was also very disappointed, and I wanted to ask her, are you sure you knew what wait on the Lord meant? But she was not in a position to answer. So one of my sisters sent a text and it said, I never lose, either I win or I learn. And so I thought, I'm not winning with this waiting, so I'm going to learn. And so I started searching and researching to find out what did it mean to wait on the Lord. And I found the word kava, Q-A-V-A-H. And it was used by the ancient Hebrews long before the time of Jesus. And persons who practice kava, they stayed in joyous anticipation at all times. They were always giving praise, they were rejoicing, they were giving thanks, they were glad. They did not look at their problems. In fact, they had no problems. They saw everything as the next step in their journey towards praising God, towards seeing God develop in their lives. And so they never ever worried. In fact, to describe Kava, it's like a child on Christmas morning who just can't wait to open their gifts. They don't know what's in the gift, but they know it's gonna be good. It's going to be great. And so I realized that, yes, I was waiting on the Lord in a pious or pitiful way. I was just praising and waiting, but not exercising a real faith, not anticipating anything good. In other words, I was just saying, wait on the Lord, wait on the Lord. But that was not good enough, because waiting is not a passive thing. It is a joyous, joyous anticipation. And so I went through the Bible again, and I found Isaiah 40:31. And it said, they that cover shall be revitalized, shall be restored, shall be renewed. In other words, they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. And Philippians 4:6 said, be not anxious for anything, but in everything, through praise and thanksgiving, make your request known. And then I found where Elijah was asked to pray for rain, and he just said, go eat and drink, sounding like my mother. Oh, wait on the Lord, you know. He never said, let's pray for this. He just said, go eat and drink, because he was confident that rain was going to come. And that's when I also discovered that persons who prayed for the rain weren't praying for the rain to fall. They were praying because they knew it was going to fall at some point in time. And so I also read The Angels Within Us by John Randolph Price. And he says the only prayer that anyone really needs to pray is a prayer of gratitude. Because no matter what you're going through, there's one presence and power, infinite God, infinite love, and there is going to be a solution, and it's going to be a wonderful solution. The solution doesn't come immediately because of us, because we're worrying, because we're fretting, because we're anxious. But if we move away from all of that, there is a beautiful solution. He has a friend by the name of Francis Fuchs who wrote Effectual Prayer. And Mr. Fuchs says, okay, your car is not working. You have no job. You have no joy. Pray to God. But remember, your prayer must be one of praise, because God already knows your problem. You don't need to be going to God asking. You don't need to open a catalog, begging him for something. He already knows. The presence and the power knows what you want, and it's coming. Exercise some acceptance, exercise some patience, because it's coming to you. And again, Mr. John Randolph Price sums it up for me perfectly when he refers to 2 Chronicles 20:17, which says, in the battle, do not fight. Take your position, stand firm, and see the victory of the Lord. Mm-hmm. In the battle, which is your challenge, do not talk about it. Do not call your friends on the phone. Do not worry about it. But take the position that all is well. All is well. All is well. And then stand by that position that you have taken and see the victory of the Lord. In other words, as Jesus said, seek ye first the kingdom and all is well. So why wait? Because we can praise, because we can rejoice. We can accept our good. We can anticipate our good. We can appreciate where we are right now, and we can give thanks always. Friends.
Wow. Well, when I grew up, I wanted to be able just to quote the Bible without no notes. Just, you know, as it says in Isaiah, you know? Fabulous, fabulous, fabulous. Well, friends, in the Taoist tradition, there are 5 basic tenets or beliefs that help us and help its practitioners to practice this kava, this waiting on the law to do its perfect work for us. The first tenet is, if I believe that life gives me nothing, life will oblige. Because the beautiful Jesus reminds us, to him that hath shall be given, and to him that hath not shall be taken away, even the little that he hath. And I used to think that's a very, very harsh edict for the master teacher to have made. But what he was saying, as he always was, he was talking about consciousness. And he was saying, those that have a consciousness of abundance, get more abundance. And those that have a consciousness of lack and limitation and having nothing, what do they get? Lack and limitation and abundance. The second tenet is, if I believe that nobody can be trusted, then the law of attraction will bring me what? Distrust. Again, the master teacher said, it is done unto you as you believe. So whatever you believe is going to be handed to you. And it's like an iceberg, you know. On the top, there's like a third, you know, of the things we say. Yes, I believe that God is all there is. And I believe the only thing I have to do is wait on the Lord. But underneath the surface, there is two-thirds. And that two-thirds is where our deep, deep fears and our deep, deep misunderstandings and all the things we were told from we were Liam's size coming up. Big boys don't cry, you know. So we believe that at a deep level. And then when we find that we are moved to tears on the surface, we feel ashamed because we are moved to tears. I love it at in our outreach ministry at the correctional services, you know, that big men in prison can cry. And I think it's such a wonderful, wonderful gift that they can learn that it's okay to feel the emotions and to express them. Author Philip Dunn, who translated the ancient Taoist lesson on how to create balance within ourselves so we can live in harmony, said, and I quote, "You cannot make peace out of war, and if you try to make peace out of war, then eventually war will again be made out of peace." Mm-hmm. "Peace is not truly made," he says. "It is everywhere around us. True peace is the best kept secret in the history of mankind, a secret kept by nature and by the planet herself." And that's what Charmalyne's mother, when she said, "Wait on the Lord." Let us all do it. Wait on the Lord. You know, just flash your hand. Wait on the Lord. Pickney, you know. So, as religious scientists, we know that it makes no sense, my friends, and this is one I really want to concentrate on today, to wage war against poverty, to wage war against crime, to wage war against drugs or violence against women or any other negative condition. To fight what we are against will, according to the divine law of cause and effect, keep that very thing we do not want tightly bound to us. Does that make sense?
Yes.
Good. It therefore makes more sense to think of and speak about what we stand for. Let us affirm together, I stand for peace.
I stand for peace.
Do me a favor, those that are not holding babies and have reggae knees, please stand. Let us have a neurological link between what we say and what we do. Let's say now, I stand for peace.
I stand for peace.
I stand for peace in my country.
I stand for peace in my country.
I stand for peace among nations.
I stand for
I stand for peace within communities and families.
I stand for peace within communities and families.
I stand for peace within myself.
I stand for peace within myself.
Thank you. Please be seated. You know, in John 14:27, Jesus says, "My peace I give unto you, not as the world giveth, give I unto you. Let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid." I think he was like Charmalyne's mother, wait on the Lord. Yes, friends, the peace that was being promised passes human understanding because it's a deep peace. It's that two-thirds of the iceberg below the surface that is imperturbable. You can't disturb it because it is rooted in the peace of the eternal. It is unshakable. It is unmovable. It is the peace that is the truth, the center and the circumference of our very being. According to Roker Erico, and since Charmalyne was dropping on your cover, you know, from the Hebrew, let me drop a little on you too. Beautiful. According to Roker Erico, the Aramaic scholar, in Aramaic, which is the language Jesus spoke, the word for peace is shlama. In Hebrew, it's shalom, and in Arabic, salam. But you know, there's something very interesting about those three words in the three different languages. And I always wonder why we're in such a war, because we're all Abrahamic traditions. We all come from the same root. You know that. So in those three languages, there's another meaning for shalom, shlama, and salam. And it is this. The other meaning is to surrender. To surrender. So when you meet a stranger and you say shalom, what you are saying is, I surrender to you. And someone who surrenders to you, do you then trample on them and abuse them? No, you raise them up. You lift them up and say, yes, my brother, and I surrender to you. So it's another way of saying, I place everything in God's hands. I surrender. I wait on the Lord. Wouldn't it be wonderful if every one of us in Jamaica surrendered to that inner, unutterable peace that is within all of creation? And you know what keeps us from experiencing it? The big frog, fear. We learn fear at such a tender age. You know, that's why I want all parents and godparents to be so careful when they're nurturing children. You know, a little polar lizard runs past you in the nursery. And that little thing learns at a very early age, here is something monstrous and awful. I never have been able to understand how we can live in a country like Jamaica, which is the tropics, and we're afraid for lizards. Hands up those who are afraid for lizards and live with the bagon. Yes, I see the hands. Stop destroying God's creation. I want to teach you something this morning, which is a very powerful but simple strategy which you can employ when faced with a scary situation. It's called the bell hand. It's really a simple movement that will help calm your nervous system. And here it is. With either hand, you can do it with either hand. Just gently bring all your fingertips together to touch your thumb. And then just for 7 times, open it to the shape of a bell and close it. 1, close. 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. The hand doesn't open more than enough to create the shape of the bell, and it comes together again. And the movement sends a kind of neural all is well signal to your brain, and it is impossible to continue this movement if you're tense. So just making the bell hand and doing it 7 times will relax the tension in you. Next time parents, one of your children are getting on your last nerve, you just go. Something, do you? Anything wrong, Mom? No, dear. No, dear. Your husband comes home late. Your wife locks you out the bedroom. You're on the couch. It's called the bell hand. The fourth tenet is, if I'm joyous, compassionate, and peaceful, first of all within myself, all of life will coincide. You know, to some people who just exude. It used to be like that with me, with Reverend Elma. I'd walk into her office and suddenly go, I would suddenly relax. It was as if her very being in her presence, she just exuded peace. So years ago, I copied in my journal something that RSI Minister Reverend Betty Ann Brennan had said. She said, and I quote, I try every day to never dilute peace. I try every day to never dilute peace. I wrote it in my journal, and then I began pondering if that may have some connection to the commandment, thou shalt not commit adultery. Because if you look up the word adulterate, it means to add something inferior that waters down the effect and the strength of the thing that you're watering. So I wonder, do we adulterate our relationships with unforgiveness? Do we hold resentments and that pours something inferior into the beautiful love that we have said that we feel and that we are and that is our values? Let us not commit adultery. Let us stand for peace and mean it. And if we find that peace is being threatened, bell hand. Simple, simple, simple thing you can do anywhere. You're at the traffic light and you know, instead of honking your horn because the person in front of you hasn't moved off immediately and adulterate the peace, just bell hand before you move off. In our correctional ministry, which I mentioned earlier, Reverend Michael Record and I ask participants to answer three questions. Whom do I blame? What am I ashamed of? And what regrets do I still carry? Who do I blame? What am I ashamed of? And what regrets do I still carry? And it's amazing to watch the lights go off in their eyes when they come to the recognition that there is nobody to blame but themselves, you know. And then there's one step from that. And who do I need most to forgive? Myself for messing up, you know. And then I can then turn my back on the regrets because I can say, this is an opportunity to do better. This is an opportunity, Charmalyne said, to learn while I'm waiting on the law. There's an amusing Hindu story which exemplifies how we constantly blame other people, how we put blame into effect. It's a story about a man who was, he was to be attending a peace rally of all things, and he was driving in India along a lonely road, and he began to suspect that he had lost his way. So he stopped and he said to a beggar, the only person in sight on the road, is this the way to Delhi? And the man said, I don't know. And he said, well, does this road lead to Agra? And the man said, I don't know. So getting annoyed about the lack of an answer to his question, he said, you don't know much, do you? And the beggar laughed and said, but I am not lost. So you see, friends, we have to walk the talk. So this brings me to your assignment, should you decide to undertake it. Your assignment is to look back over your list of goals for this year. If you were at the New Year's workshop, you may have made a list of goals, or you may just have them written somewhere. Look over your list of goals for this year, and beside each one write, I wait on the law with joyous expectancy. I wait on the law with joyous expectancy. And now, Charmalyne and I did not collaborate on this talk. It's just amazing. And yet still, the two things just fit so beautifully together. Can we say that? I wait on the law with joyous expectancy. I wait on the law with joyous expectancy. Thank you, God. We must always give thanks. Can we say, thank you, God? Make a note of it in your program. I wait on the law with joyous expectancy. Thank you, God. The fifth and final Doris tenet is directly linked to our desire to enjoy peaceful lives, and it is this. Whatever I pray of, life will grant me instantly. And notice I said pray of. In this teaching, we don't pray for things, because if you pray for something, the suggestion is that you really believe at a deep level, that part of the iceberg that's below the surface, that you don't have it. And as we said earlier, peace already is. Perfection already is. Your prosperity and abundance already is. All you need to do is to accept it. So we do prayers of peace, prayers of abundance, prayers of love, prayers of prosperity. All you need to do is to wait upon the law and to seek its guidance. You know, it reminds me of the Irish prisoner who dug a tunnel under the prison wall and managed to escape. And he came up, of all places, right in the middle of a children's playground. And there was a little girl on a swing, swinging away. And when he got out of the tunnel, he said, I'm free! I'm free! I'm free! And she said, that no nothing, I'm four. So, let me just give you the five tenets. If I believe that life gives me nothing, life will oblige. If I believe that nobody can be trusted, life will bring me the distrust. If I believe that I must fight to win, then life will bring me battles. If I am joyous, compassionate, and at peace, life will coincide. And whatever I pray of, life will give me instantly. Please turn to the inside cover of your program with me. It has our Declaration of Principles and five bullet points down. One, two, three, four, five. And just say this with me. We believe the ultimate goal of life to be a complete emancipation from all discord of every nature, and that this goal is sure to be attained by all. This is the truth, my friends, and nothing can adulterate it. Namaste.